value as 1. So this is the default value starting from 10 up to 19, 10 with step value 1, 11, 12 and so on up to 19, because this is exclusive of 20, exclusive of stop value. So this range is generated. Now this step value is also optional. As I told you, this is optional. And if I don't give it, it is assumed as 1, default is 1. If this one is also optional, if you don't give it, it is taken as 0. So that is a range. So we'll demo. So we'll start day 8, day 6. I think I'll increase the font size. Is it visible? Okay, I think it's visible. So this is the 6. So in this will take range. So when I take suppose range, so question range, so it gives range of values 1 to 10. So it will give up to 1 to 9. And actually it will not give the sequence. It will, if I try to print this, it will give the just starting and ending point. So that's what it gives. So it is getting connected. Now it, because range is an object, so range is an object, it is not, it will not store the entire sequence, but whenever required, it generates the sequence. Means if I start using for loop, it generates the sequence. It will store only starting and ending values. Now suppose if I want the entire sequence, so what I can do is I can take a list. What is list? I'll give you later. Just if I want the entire range, I can use this. And now if I print this list next after loops, we are going to see that. Or after strings, we'll see. So it will give the entire range. So this is how the range is obtained. But if I take the range simply, it will not store the entire sequence. Now, when I convert into list, it will give the entire sequence. Or if I take for loop, each time the for loop is executed, it will give one the next element in the sequence. That's how the range works. Now, if I further take the range, if I take list here, I'll take the entire thing here, I'll copy. If I take this, now I'll not give starting value, I'll give the ending value as suppose 12. Then it will give the range from 0 to 11, because default starting value is 0 and the end is excluded, and so it is 0 to 11. Now if I take again one more, if I give the starting value and also ending value here, suppose if I give 20, now starting from 1 to 20, each time it should be incremented by 2. So it will give 1, 3, 5, 7, so on. That is how we get it, because the range is not 1, it is 2. So it is 1, 3, 5, 7, it will give like that. Next, suppose if I take, I can also take the range which is decreasing. So if I say 21 to 10, excluding 10, suppose if I give minus 1, it will go up to 21 to 11. So 21 to 11 it gives, because now the step size is minus 1, so it will be keep on decremented. So this is how we can use the range. But if I take simply range, by default, it will not give the sequence. It will store the starting, ending and step values. Based on, suppose if I convert into list or if I use in for loop, I can get the sequence one at a time. If it is list, it will give the entire sequence because list maintains a series of numbers. Now, if I take for loop each time, it will give next element in the sequence. So that is range, a simple built-in facility that is available in Python. Now, if I take the for loop, how for loop is used in this case. So if I take for loop, the syntax of for loop. For loop syntax is for some item, data item, in generally we give the range. Not necessarily range, we can give anything, range, and some range we give. Then what it does is, now we can have some statements. Whatever statements we have, we can have these statements. So some problem with this. Okay, we can have these statements, and these statements. Now what happens is for this item takes a value in the range from beginning to end. From beginning to end for each iteration of the loop. For each iteration of the loop. Each iteration of the loop. Now, if I take this code here, the simple code we write. Now I can take for I in range, suppose if I say 10, if I say 10, then I value takes the values from the set of values from the range one at a time. So I'll say print I. So it is giving here 0, 1, 2, 3 up to 9. So I value, what it takes is, it takes first value in the range, which is 0. Next, one iteration of the loop is repeated. Then I takes the next value, and so on. Now here, one important thing to note here is, print, what it is doing is, now we'll learn much about print. So print, what it does is, it will print whatever data item you give, it will print. Then after it prints the data item, it prints new line also. It prints new line. So that's why we are getting here. After printing I, it is going to the next line. Then after printing one, it is going to the next line. So this you can control by taking one argument, keyword argument called end. So if I say end equals to, suppose, space, now instead of new line, it will give space after printing the data item. So now I will take the same here again. Now what I can do is, I can say I, after that end equals to, I'll give space. Now it prints each item with a space, not new line. Now you are getting space. Now suppose instead of space, if you want comma, so you can keep comma. So after printing that, it prints, gives comma. Suppose whatever you want, you can give it. Suppose if you want colon, so it will give colon. Now by default it is backslash n, which is new line. By default it is new line. So same as the earlier one, even if you don't give it, it is new line, or you can also give tab space. So five spaces in between. So you can control the way you, the print, the way the print, the way printing should happen. You can control it with the end. With end, you can control it with the end, the way the print works. So this is one point to note. So according to your requirement, after printing data item, if you want a line, then you need not do anything. If you don't want line, if you want any other thing, then use end here. So I want comma after that, or I want space, give space here. Now it will give you the space. So this is one print control you can do in Python. So we'll come back to for loop. Now the for loop, not only you can work on range. Suppose if I have a string, if I take Python, now I can take for loop on this string. I can say for char in for ch in str. So for every, it is not only range, I can take any other collection. We are going to learn about string and other collections little later. Now what this does is, it will take one character at a time from the string whatever you have given. So if I say print ch and I don't want to have a new line, so I can say here comma equals to, I can say comma, so then the characters will be printed with comma. CH type object is not available. Sorry, this to 1 minute. Str is a keyword. So what I'll do is I'll take str1 because str is already keyword in Python. So I'll take this, that is better. So I'll exclude this, then I'll exclude this. Now you'll get for every character, the loop is repeated. Means for first iteration, ch takes the value p. For second iteration, ch takes the value y. For third iteration, t, and so on. Now, suppose if I want, normally if you take, you might be knowing about the ASCII characters, our ASCII codes. So if you want ASCII codes of, okay, 1 minute. So if I want ASCII characters of each one, like I can take for ch in str1. Now ASCII characters, ASCII codes of the characters that are there in str1, I can say ch. Then ORD, ORD gives ASCII character, so CH, then I'll give, after that, in between, I'll give colon, then I'll give space after that. So then I'll say end, I'll give tab space. And if I execute this, now what it does is, so P, capital P's ASCII value is 80, small y's ASCII value is 121, T's ASCII value is 116, H's ASCII value is 104, and so on. So you may be knowing ASCII value. So if you don't know, just briefly I'll give what is ASCII value here. Just within 2 minutes I'll give it, because all may not be knowing about the ASCII value, so it is better. If I give throw some light on ASCII values. Okay. Now when I take the because computer understands only and only zeros and ones, the all the characters that are there on the keyboard are represented with some code. The code, the standard code which was popular, is ASCII. Actually ASCII is no more available, it is replaced with Unicode, but still Unicode takes the same values for ASCII characters. So just we'll see American Standard Code for Information Interchange. For A, capital A, it is ASCII code is 65, capital B, it is 66, and so on. Capital Z, it is 90. Similarly, small a, it is 97, small b, it is 98, and so on. Small z, it is 122. Y, you might have got 121, see here, why you are getting 121. So this is ASCII code. Similarly, even digits, like 0 will have ASCII value 48, 1 will have ASCII value 49, and so on. 9 will have ASCII value 57. Now suppose if I take the code here, str1 as Python 3, so Python 3 we are using the software. So if I execute this again, so it is giving now ASCII value of 3 as 51, because when I take ASCII value 48 is 0, 49 for 1, 50 for 2, and 51 for 3. So this is how the for loop is very useful. So if you want to run through different collections, then for loop is useful. It is not only this, there are so many other flexibilities of for loop which we are going to see, but generally it is actually generally combined with range, like what we have seen. Now suppose if I take another for loop here for I in range, suppose 10 to 30 with 3 as step size, then I'll print I value, print I, and I don't want a new line with every character. So I'll say end space. So now 10, 13, 16, that's how we get 10, 13, 16, 19, 22, 25, 28. So the last end value will be excluded. So that is about the for loop. Now we'll be discussing much about for loop because it is very frequently used loop in Python. And not only loop, it is very frequently used component in Python. So we'll be very frequently using that. We'll come back to for loop later. We'll see the other control structures. Like I have already seen the different control structures. Like I've seen if, within if we have seen different, then loops we have seen, like while loop and for loop. The next control structure we are going to see is break and continue. These are the two control structures. Now when I take break, first we'll see break. Now normally when I take a loop, whether it is for loop or while loop, so there is loop header and there is loop body. Now, when I take the loop header, if it is while loop, there will be condition. If it is for loop, generally there will be range. Now, the termination of the loop happens from the header. If termination happens from the header, this termination is called as normal termination. So, loop is executed from the beginning to end without any problem, and the loop has terminated normally. This is normal termination. Now, sometimes there is some condition or situation that is arising inside the loop. We may have to terminate from the body of the loop. This kind of termination is called as abrupt termination. So the abrupt termination, the only way of terminating the body of the loop suddenly in the middle is break. So break statement, what it does is, at that instance of time, the loop is terminated. Normally the loop is terminated, if it is while loop, the loop is terminated when the condition is false. If it is for loop, the loop is terminated when the entire sequence is run, we have run through the entire sequence, then only the loop is terminated. For some reason, if I want to terminate the loop suddenly, at that instance of time, break is used. So when I take a break, is a control structure which terminates the loop, at that instance of time. So suddenly it will terminate, instance of time where from inside the body of the loop, it will be terminated from inside the body of the loop. So this is actually the break. It is in Python, we don't use this control structure frequently. We use for loop very frequently. If is very common, but while is very rare, and also the break continue also very rare. But sometimes the break is useful. Now I'll write one code here. One code I want to write which uses break. So one minute. Write a program to read 10 numbers and sum of them. This is the requirement. During reading, a negative number is encountered. Stop the process immediately. So this is one thing I want. So this I can do it with for loop. So this is the question. So I'll reduce the size. So what I'll do is I want to read 10 numbers. So I'll take one variable called sum because I want to find the sum for i in range 10. So I want to read, so I'm taking a range. So first, what it says is write a program to read 10 numbers and find sum. But during reading, suppose if negative number is encountered, so negative number is encountered, stop. We should stop. So it is abnormal termination, because as per the requirement, we want all positive numbers. 10 numbers, I'm saying it should be positive as per that. Now I'll try to read number. So num equals to int. To read, I have to use input. So I'll not be displaying any message because input returns string. I am using int to convert it. Then if num less than zero, I have to terminate abruptly. So this is break. So this is abrupt termination. Otherwise, what I have to do is add that num to sum. So here finally print sum. Now to make it somewhat simple, so I'll take 5 because 10 I have to enter 10 numbers. So I'll exclude this. So it will try to read 5 numbers. If I enter all positive numbers, it will try to read 10 numbers. Suppose in between, if I enter negative number, then it will stop. So first number 10 I'm entering, second number 20 I'm entering, third number 30 I'm entering, then 40. So if I'm entering all numbers as per the requirement of the program, it will take all 5 numbers, then it will display the sum. So that's what it is doing. Now if I execute it again, so I'll take 10, I am entering 20. Next, if I enter minus 5, so it will stop. It will not read 5 numbers. So that is break. So break, what it does is, whenever it will break, terminates the loop abruptly at that instance of time. When it terminates, whenever some abnormal condition is occurring. Here, the normal input what we require is all positive numbers. Negative number here is considered as abnormal thing. So when abnormal thing happens, the loop will be terminated abruptly. So when no negative number is entered, then the I'll take this here and explain, that is better. So when I take this here, when I take this code, so when I enter all positive numbers, the termination happens here. When I enter all positive numbers, the termination happens from the header. And it will terminate. Okay, when suppose some abnormal thing occurs, then the termination happens from here. So if termination happens from the body of the loop, it is normal termination. That's what I told you. It is normal termination. If the termination happens somewhere from the body of the loop, it is abnormal termination. The abnormal termination happens only with the help of break. So break is used to stop the loop at that instance of time. Suddenly, so that is abnormal termination, that is break. Now that is, we are going to use break I think relatively more number of times compared to while and other things, but continue is very rarely used, but still I'll give you about continue. Now when I take continue, the continue, what it does, it is similar to break, but it will do a different action, not termination of the program. So whenever some condition is satisfied, like break condition is satisfied, some condition whatever you have built, it's satisfied, what it will do is, it will skip the remaining statements of the loop. If you know C, break and continue are for same purpose. If you don't know C, then you can pay some attention here. Condition satisfied, it will skip the remaining statements of the loop. And continue the loop. That is with the important thing. And continue the next iteration of the loop. Next iteration, it will not terminate next iteration of the loop. So now you will understand when we take the example. Now my requirement here is, what I am doing is, I am taking this is earlier requirement. Now my requirement here is, write a program to read 10 numbers and find the sum during reading. If negative number is encountered, don't stop the process, but during reading negative number is encountered, do not use it for summing. So it will read always 10 numbers or 5 numbers, whatever we have fixed. it will always read 10 numbers even if you give negative number. But only thing is that negative number will not be included in summing. So here you can use the continue. Now what I'll do is I'll take the same thing. I'll take same thing, but I'll remove break and keep continue. So here, now if negative number is encountered, I'm stopping the process of reading. But if here negative number is encountered, what it does is it will not terminate the loop. It will not terminate the loop, but it will skip the remaining statements of the loop for that particular step. So I'll take this here. Okay, here, suppose if I enter first, sum is 0. If I enter first 10, then 10 is red. It is not less than 0. Then it will continue. It will all the statements are executed. Sorry, sum is initially 0. When it is positive number, this is added. Next, I am entering 20. 20 is positive number. It is added. Now when I enter minus 5, now minus 5, what it will do is it will not stop the program. It will not stop the program. If it is break, it stops. What it will do is it will skip the remaining. How it will skip? How it will skip is from here it will go directly to the header and continues the loop. So this statement is skipped. So for minus 5, loop is not going to be terminated, but minus 5 will not be considered for addition. Next, I'm entering 30. So 30 is added here. Next, I'm entering 15. 15 is added. So except this, remaining statements are used. Remaining statements are considered for summing. How we are doing with the help of continue? Continue, what it will do, it will skip the remaining statements for that particular iteration, but it will not terminate the loop. It will continue with the next iteration. So that is how it is executed. So now if I execute this, I'll execute this. So first I'm entering 10. First I'm entering 10. So it is considered for addition. Then I'm entering 5. It is considered for addition. Then I'm entering minus 5. It will not terminate. It will continue. But minus 5 will not be considered for summing. Then I'm entering suppose 11. Then it will consider for summing. Then I enter 2, it will consider for summing. Now 5 numbers are red. In that only one number is negative. For that negative number, these remaining statements are skipped. So now if you exclude minus 5 and add remaining, so 11 plus 2, 13 plus 5, 18 plus 10, 28 will be the output. So that is the continue statement. Continue statement will skip the remaining part of the remaining, will skip the remaining statement for that particular iteration, but skips continue with the next iteration of the loop. So this is one important thing. Okay, one important thing of the control structure. Now one more thing which is special to Python, not there in other languages, is loop with else. Loop with else. Now this is not there in other languages. If you take any language, if you take Java language or C language, else is always combined with if. But in Python, else is combined with for loop, and else is combined with while loop. Else is combined with for loop, and else is combined with for loop. Okay, this is how it is actually linked. So now what happens when else is executed is, I told you when I take the loop, whether it is for loop or while loop, so when I take loop, loop will have header, loop will have body, and you may also attach else with the loop. Now, when there are two kinds of terminations here, I told you there are two kinds of terminations for loop. So one is normal termination, another is abnormal termination. Some inside the body of the loop, if you terminate, it is abnormal termination. So it is abnormal termination. Now this when I take this else part, the else part of the loop is executed. Else part of the loop is executed only when the loop is terminated normally. So that is one important thing. Else part of the loop is executed only when the loop is terminated normally. The loop is terminated normally. If it is terminated abnormally, then the else part is not going to be executed. This is one specialty of Python. No other language has this facility. Loop is else is associated with only if in other languages, but in Python else is also associated with loop. So when loop is terminated normally, normal termination, it will go to else part. If it is abnormal termination, it will go to next to else part. So this is one thing you should note with Python. So we'll write one program here. The program, what it does is read a number. And check whether it is prime or not. So this is one program to check whether the number is prime or not. Now there are different ways of finding whether a number is prime or not. So normally in school days we might have learned that the definition of prime number. So what the definition of prime number says is, if you take some number n, n is said to be prime, is prime if it is divided by 1 and itself. Prime if it is divided only by 1 and itself. So if I want to decide whether n is prime or not as per this definition, suppose if I take some number 23, start dividing 23 from 1, 2 and so on up to 23, count number of times this number gets divided. If the count is 2, it is prime, otherwise it is not prime. So this is one logic. So I'll quickly write this logic, but it is not efficient. So first I'll read a number. So num equals to int input. I'll say enter a number. Now I'll take some count equals to 0. This is actually one thing we had to do. Here what we can do is, for I in range 1 to n plus 1, num plus 1, because num, if I give, num will be excluded. So num plus 1, if I give, num will be included. So if num percentage I equals to 0, then count plus equals to 1, I'm counting. Then after coming out of the loop, if count equals to 2, print num is prime, otherwise we say num is not prime. This is not a good logic, but still I am writing num is not prime. So I'll exclude this. So I'll take 25. So 25, it says not prime. I'll execute again. So I'll give 37, which is a prime number. So it says prime. But actually, this is not considered to be efficient. Suppose if I take some number, if I take some number 1024, so it is divisible by 2. As soon as it is divisible by one number, we need not continue and check with other divisions. That is one thing. Second thing is we need not start from 2, start from 2, go up to n by 2. That is enough. Not even n by 2, you can go up to square root of n by 2. That is enough. And during this, if I take this range 2 to square root of n by 2, if the number gets divided with any number, I need not continue. I can say break. Then I can execute, I can get the result correctly. So for example, if I take this, if I take the number, how many steps we are executing here, that also I'll take. Each time I execute the loop, I'll take the step. So here, then to decide some number, whether it is prime or not, so I'll say steps equals to plus equals to 1. Now the number of steps taken to do this, I'll say print. This is how your program should be. I'll take number of steps taken to perform this job. I'll display which is steps. Now I'll execute this. Now I'll take some number 1024. Now to decide whether 1024 is prime or not, it is taking 1024 steps. So it is unnecessary. Now if I use this logic, I'll take from 2 to square root of n, square root of n, not n by 2, square root of n, then that is one thing. As soon as it gets divided successfully, I need not continue. Then that is one more advantage. So I'll take this code and modify. And here, the else part also plays a role. That's why I have taken this example. So it is giving several concepts here. Now this else part is with the loop, with if, not with the loop. So I'll take this. I'll take this code. So observe this code clearly. So here I'll take max range, MR, end of the range. I'll take it as, I have to take math here to find the square root. So I'll say import math, because square root is part of math. I'll say math module. So I'll say math.sqrt num. Then I have to take here end plus 1, because I had to include that value. Now I'll start from 2, not from 1. Then what else I'll do is, I don't require this. Count I don't require. I'll simply say print this not a prime statement. I'll keep it here. Not prime statement. I'll change it and keep it here. Then I'll keep break here. The number of steps I'll count as it is, and prime I'll keep it with else. I'll explain this logic. Try to understand. I'll explain this logic after executing. Now this is the best way of finding whether a number is prime or not. Now I'll execute this. So if I execute this, So I want to check 1024 whether it's prime or not. So somewhere print num is prime, somewhere some error. We'll check what is the error. Float object cannot be, sorry, here. When I take this, you convert it to int. Int, I'll convert it into int. Because in the range, you cannot have float. So 1024, I'll keep. Now it is saying here steps within first step. So I'll start steps from one. Within one step, it says 1024 is not a prime. So I'll say 1024. Within one step, it says 1024 is not a prime. So that is what we want, because once 1024 gets divided by 2, I need not further continue to check whether 1024 is prime or not. Suppose if it is a prime number, so if I take 97, it will take some steps, 97 square root of 10. So it is, I think, takes 10 or 9 steps to decide. So it is taking 9 steps to decide 97 is prime. So this is the logic, and here I am using else with for. Now I'll explain this. I'll explain this logic. So here what it does is, if it is a prime, suppose if I am taking some number 23, so I'll take some number, math don't take it, I'll take this number here, so num is 23. Now 23 square, if I take, it is 5, so it will start from 2 to 5 plus 1, 6 means it will go up to 5. So if 23 is not divided by 2, 23 is not divided by 4, 23 is not divided by 5, then it ends, range is ended. So range is ended, then it is normal termination, then it goes and says it's a prime. Goes it and it says a prime. So this else is for this for loop. Now by chance, if the number is getting divided by some value, then I'm saying print is not a prime. Now it will not go to else part, because the termination here happening is abnormal termination. It will not go to else part. It will go to the next step of else part. Is it clear the use of else part? So the here else part is very useful. I am not using any count here. Actually, this count is not required. Count is also not required. For this particular, because there is a else. Suppose if I am taking C programming and other things, steps here I am using to indicate how fast the things are happening here. So for example, suppose if I take this logic, now if I am entering some big number like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, suppose if I am entering this number, to decide whether this is prime or not, it takes so many steps, and finally it says it's not a prime. So it is taking so much time it is taking. So that is the problem with this logic, because even if it gets divided, it is keep on doing the job. So I'm taking huge number, so it is taking some time. So it is still going on. So it is still going on. So taking so much time and so many steps, it is happening. Then finally it says, so that is the problem with the logic. It is taking so much time, and finally it is saying it's not a prime. because I'm taking very huge number and doing it, it is taking some time. Just let it complete, or we can terminate it because it is keep on taking so much time. So I'll terminate. So or wait till it is completed. Okay, I'll terminate this, and same thing, if you give it to the next logic, it is also job is same, within no time it completes the job. So now I'll execute this, and within no time it says not a prime. So that is the difference between the logic, and I'm not even using count, and this else part is linked with the for loop. So the else part of a loop is executed only when the termination happens normally. In another way, if the loop is terminated with break, then else part is not going to be executed. So that is the else loop with else. Have understood? Okay. That is about control structures. Now the routine, only specialty here. Now if I take C language here, almost whatever we have learned up to here, it is like a C language. Except some things what you can note is, we have seen the dynamic nature of Python, which is with the help of dynamic typing and dynamic size, then loop with else. These features, except these features, like operators and all, if you take break, if you take continue, take even if you take while loop and for loop, to some extent it is same as C. Except these differences, whatever we have learned, it is like C language only. Now, before we go to next topic, which is strings, which is slightly different from the C language. It is also matching, but it is slightly different. What I wanted to do is, I wanted to have a quiz, quick quiz, online quiz, which you can attend with your mobile. I'll start a quiz. Don't bother about how many marks you get, just attend it to enjoy the quiz. It is very simple case, whatever concept you have learned on Python, very simple concept.